In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. O Lord,
you are the light who shone upon those who were in darkness, and they were illuminated. Upon the blind they recovered their sight. Let your face now shine upon us, and we shall be illumined by you. Walk in the way of your gospel teaching, and glorify the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Saint Maron,
pray for us.
And the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. All right, so of course we're going to continue on with the letter of the patriarch. And what's interesting about these things is that if you put it purely in a psychological context of what's gone on for the last, especially the last 50 years in the Western world, longer than that actually, but specifically, there's been a lot of the attitude of, well, those are just human rules. Those are just human rules. Those are just human rules. And of course, in the church, you never claim that everything that goes on within the church is divine law. But with the attitude, what we're going to continue with is there's a psychology behind the ascetic life that once rules no longer exist, or rules only become something that are just rules, then what happens is we lose habits, but we also lose many more profound things going on. So I'm going to give you a quotation from St. Athanasius in Egypt. So St. Athanasius the Great, he is slightly older than St. Maron. He's during the 300s. But he gives a statement about fasting as this ascetic practice. And you have to remember that when you read the Gospels, Christianity from the beginning is not just simply a path to salvation. It is an ascetic path. Anyone who wishes to follow me must take up his cross daily and follow me. He who loves father, mother, brother, sister more than me is not worthy of me. He who has left father, mother, brother, sister, lands, spouse, lands for my sake shall receive 100-fold in this life and life everlasting in the next. The entire Christian movement is ascetic from the beginning. And we have, for the first 3 weeks of the Great Fast, we have in the Fitgomo, after the reading, when we say, quotation from the Gospels, and our Lord says, that they do not fast while the bridegroom is present, but when the bridegroom is taken away, they shall fast. So there is a whole ascetic movement behind it, and also an aspect of the presence, the matrimonial relationship between the church and Christ. Okay? So, St. Athanasius, when he speaks about fasting, he says, devils take great delight in fullness. My belly is content. Right? The devils take great delight in fullness and drunkenness and bodily comfort. Love my lazy boy. Fasting possesses great power, and it works glorious things. To fast, this is his most famous quotation about it, to fast is to banquet with angels. So it's the way he puts in a contrast that we are standing in opposition to the demonic, and how the demonic is really quite happy when you're really comfy. And we're going to talk a bit about this now. What, if we look back on page 5 of the Letters of the Patriarch, and we left off with the notion of sacramental mystery. So this must be what really struck everybody when we talked about the sacrament and what it does through sacramental grace. Otherwise, I don't know specifically. No one's told. They just went, whoa. But no one, so I think just simply the explanation of the sacred mysteries of what takes place. So we left off with that. Now, in the second part, number 7, is where we left off at. The patriarch says that repentance is necessary and indispensable for the salvation of man. Okay, so it is that on Sunday, again, in my head, everything is coherent. So Sunday goes from Sunday, Sunday links Wednesday, Wednesday's links Sunday, and even during the week in the little sermons that come up Tuesday through Friday, they're all linked. So Dame Fifa gets the full dose of a continuity of doctrinal exposition of the Maronite Catholic faith, because she's here for everything. God bless her.
Rita too.
And Rita also, yes, that's true. I'm sorry. Mea culpa. All right, so when he talks about repentance here, then, the other word that we can use for indispensable is it's irreplaceable. Nothing else in Christianity can replace the aspect of repentance. Not nice music, not nice art, nothing else can replace fidelity or the constitution of fidelity for the salvation of mankind except repentance. And he mentions here that the Lord has called for it in his first sermon. Remember that one of the luminous mysteries that's been given to us now, I've marveled actually at how well the luminous mysteries correspond in fact with the Syriac tradition, the emphasis placed upon them, and the preaching of the kingdom. This is the repentance, the preaching of the kingdom. So as the third luminous mystery, repent for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And our Lord says here in the last quotation from the Gospel of St. Luke, if you do not repent, you shall also perish. He gives them an example of people who die, some accident, tower falling, killing a number of people. And he says, do you think that they were more evil because they were killed by this event than the people who remained alive after? And he tells them, no, these things happen. But if you do not repent, you shall also likewise perish. Now, the terminology, of course, quite famously, that we translate as repentance, and I don't know if you have it up there, no, is, of course, the term which is being used is metanoia. We talked about this last year, but it never hurts to go back to these things. Remember that nous is the mind in Greek. The upper part, the higher part of our conscious perception. And so, the notion of metanous, or the action of metanoia, literally means a change, a shifting of mind. So a shifting. You can't say in English changing your mind, because that makes it sound fickle. All right. So, but we can say changing an attitude. That would be another way of talking about it. The way you perceive things has to be changed, has to be shifted. And remember on Sunday we mentioned the way we perceive comes from that illumination of the faith. That illumination of the faith and the way we perceive things means we judge things differently. And the way that we judge differently necessarily means that our actions are going to be different. And so Christianity on this ascetic path have always made people, as long as they were faithful to the gospel, has always made people that were different from the pagans that surrounded them, or just simply the people who are not following the gospel. And that transformation from perception, judgment, to action meant that the public or the social action around them eventually also became transformed. Yes?
So in other words, it's less as to what the appearance of something is, but our perception of it that really matters.
Yeah, so that's what we always talk about, yes. And so when we talk about the faith as an illumination, it's because it's clarifying the way that we are perceiving things. And that perception means that the way we judge it is also different. And because we judge and see things differently, the way we respond and act is also going to be different. That's the logic behind it. Okay? So this is the real profound notion of the repentance. And the reason why I give it here is because he's quoting from St. Peter's very first sermon on Pentecost. This is the whole foundation of the path of the gospel. What do we have to do to be saved? And he says, metanoia, change your attitude, repent. See, it's translated here as repent. And of course, as I mentioned, the English word repent comes, it's in its relation to the Latin word pena. And so the notion of a penalty or the notion of suffering, because we're changing to something, this repentance in that sense. But it's not the sense really that the Greek will give. It's a changing of the way you think so that you can obtain the forgiveness of your sins and receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Okay? And so he mentions here at the bottom of this page that Paul the Apostle also addressed the people of Athens. And the whole Athenian, I think we mentioned it last year, the whole St. Paul's moment in Athens, he tries to adapt to the world around them by talking in a philosophical manner, if you like, to the people of the world. And it's an absolute flop. No one converts. They make fun of him. It doesn't do anything. There's like two people who after that, they're like, well, that was interesting. So he makes an attempt, he quotes from the pagan poets, he makes an attempt to be like the people in the Areopagus. And like I said, it doesn't really work. But what you have here is he talks about the fact, if in this discussion with these men, is that there is a demand for all people everywhere, because he has established the day on which he will judge the world with justice. And this is a point which in the modern world also Christians seem to forget. Everyone needs Jesus Christ to arrive at heaven. Everyone. There is no salvation. Saint Peter himself says in one of his sermons in the Acts of the Apostles, there is no other name under heaven by which a man is saved except that of Jesus Christ. So this is something which is a unique path, one God, one human race, one Adam and Eve, one fall, one Messiah, one salvation, one path, one gospel, one grace, one heaven, one vision. It begins with the single hidden one, and it ends with the single hidden one. This is why St. Thomas's Summa Theologica begins with God, comes out, talks about the whole path of salvation, the death, the resurrection, and then through the life of the church, her sacraments, and returns back to God. It's a one great big circular motion from God to God. One God, one everything. Because in the modern world, we try to put it, well, you know what the modern world is, you don't have to belabor it. But what happens is it makes Catholics oftentimes, in practice, apostates. Because they wind up saying, well, Jesus is necessary for me, and I like it because my grandma was an Irish Catholic, or a French-Canadian Catholic here in Maine. And so that's why I'm Catholic. But that's not why you're Catholic. You're Catholic because that is the one path to salvation. Now, that may be why someone thinks in their head they're Catholic. And this is why it has absolutely killed the whole apostolic endeavor. Even oftentimes in our foreign missions, we're actually not necessarily evangelizing, we're just setting up better farms or clinics, which is fine, but of course, up until this modern period, the setting up of a clinic was necessary because you can't evangelize someone who's dying in the bush. So you set up to give them these means of better irrigation, get them the farm. The Jesuits did all they could to get the nomadic Indian tribes to settle down in the prairies, because it's hard to evangelize people. You have to keep following around because they keep moving. And so there's an attempt to get them to settle and become sedentary, because now we can have regular catechesis. But they didn't go out there in order to teach them better agricultural methods. They did that so that the evangelization could take place more expediently. But nowadays, oftentimes, what is the missions, the advertisement that you wind up getting is because this gives better water to this little kid, which is fine if it weren't being portrayed as a Christian mission. But with the UN, that's fine. But the Christian mission is very specific about bringing the gospel. So, that's just something to mention. Next page. In the face of all this, the bishop and the priest cannot neglect serving the sacrament of penance, which he was entrusted by virtue of his ordination. He is responsible if sinners die in their sins. You know, I know that my arrival here 2 years ago has been a bit shocking to some of our people. But because if I don't actually proclaim these things that are clearly in the catechesis, you can go and just reference these things. If I don't do this, I go to hell. You go to hell, and I go to hell. And that's why the patriarch gives us this episode from the prophet Ezekiel, in which God says to Ezekiel, I make you a watchman in Israel. And you watch on the walls, and you are to warn the people of the coming of the enemy. If you do not warn them, they will die by the invasion. And you will also be held accountable for their blood. But if you warn them, and they ignore you, as they always ignore prophets, then they will be invaded, but their blood will be upon them because you will have fulfilled your function as watchmen. You would have called out. It's always good during Lenten season when you read about the prophets. The things that the prophets were made to say are quite extraordinary. We just had a reading last week of Jeremiah. He has to go to the temple and stand in the middle of the temple and tell everyone, do not make a political military alliance with Egypt, which was the great superpower against the Chaldeans. And he's saying, don't do that because you'll all die that way. What you should do is hand yourselves over to the Chaldeans and you will live. Well, of course, the authorities in Jerusalem, you're completely a traitor. And so Jeremiah spends his adult life getting arrested continually and then ultimately killed by the people of Israel. All right? So Jeremiah has always stood out as this kind of type, this foreshadowing of the Christ. But the prophets, and so you have the references here. You can read the full episode in this prophet Ezekiel. You must warn them for me. This is part of the prophetic office of the priesthood, ultimately. We talk about the priesthood as being priest, prophet, king, sanctifying, teaching, announcing, proclaiming the prophecy, and then governing to make sure that we all move toward in a unity towards the kingdom in its fullness. When I say to the wicked, you must die, and you do not speak out to warn about their ways, they shall die in their sins. But I will hold you responsible for their blood. If, however, you do warn the wicked to turn from their ways, but they do not, then they shall die in their sins, but you shall save your life. And though I say to the wicked that they shall die, if they turn from their sin to do what is just and right, none of the sins they have committed shall be remembered against them. If they do what is right and just, they shall surely live. What the prophets are doing in this 8th century before Christ is they are also bringing into an understanding of the personal responsibility of salvation, ultimately. If you read the books of Moses, the oldest books in the Old Testament, it's a corporate sense of guilt. The individual is not emphasized. The emphasis is upon the Israel. Right? And so even when you have thou shalt not kill, single person, it's referring to Israel. First and foremost in the law, yes.
Okay, Kahuna, this isn't the Catholicism that I'm used to.
Yeah. Good.
This is good.
This is what I like to hear. I've heard enough of the opposite. It's like, what planet did you drop off of?
But this is like, I've never been raised Protestant. I mean, I was baptized here at 5 days old, yeah. So this is my place. But this is like the fire and brimstone that I envision coming from a Protestant religion. I was taught the kind, lovely.
That's there good. Too.
But
we,
this is
we
all,
did that last. That was last
know,
week, right?
But what you're saying is really news.
Because you have to have both, and that's why the patriarch. I mean, like I told you when I first started reading this last year, I thought, oh, good heavens! I mean, this is extraordinary. I mean, you'll notice on page 7, there's all kinds of references to John Paul II and the Vatican II. And they're all there. But at the same time, it's clear that he is reminding us, and as I mentioned to you a couple weeks ago, this patriarch is a teacher. This is what he did for his, you know, his professional, his priesthood is mostly in classrooms.
Father.
Yes.
How does this call to be a watchman align with the word, don't throw your pearls to swine?
It's a different context. See, because here, Ezekiel is a watchman for the people of Israel. When our Lord's talking about the not casting your pearls before swine. That is, there is always going to be an awareness of people who are not embracing the gospel. You will be discreet about what you actually believe in your communication with them. I mean, let's face it, how many Catholics these days understand anything about the Trinity? So you start talking about that to somebody else, it's, oh, you worship a three-headed God. And so that's why the first centuries of the church were the Mysterium Arcani. It was the mystery of the secret. There were things that were not told even to the catechumens until after they were baptized. And that's why you have all these series from the fathers of, even with St. Augustine, of mystagogy. There's a finishing of the catechetical teaching to you after your baptism. So you go to communion before you're actually taught about the substantial. You know that Jesus is present in that ceremony that you've never been to. Because the catechumens, if you weren't baptized, you were not allowed in the church building. Not for the ceremonies, at least. And so you were baptized knowing that this is about Jesus being present. But how exactly, that's going to be explained to you after the fact. Because we don't talk about the Eucharist, we don't talk about the Holy Trinity to people outside. And as a catechumen, technically they were still outside until being baptized.
Okay. If the ground hasn't already been made ready.
So that makes sense. So, but being a watchman here with Ezekiel, he is sent to the people of Israel. Okay.
And they should know better.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. All right, so that's why, notice when he sits here in the second line in the paragraph 9. We ask all of the bishops and the parish priests and the monks to reinvigorate the sacrament of penance in order to save the sons and daughters of our church. Well, that couldn't be made any more clearly stated. What he's asking for in this letter is he's saying, you know, we need to pull back to these traditions. Not even traditions. I mean, this is our faith. This is more than just a tradition. And so in order to free them from this state of sin and to give them the grace that the sacrament signifies. So that is what we were doing last week about the sacred mysteries, how it works, and why through the actual grace, it is the greatest vehicle towards holiness. All right? And then he mentions by canon law, we have to have it for convenient days and times suitable to them, etc. All right. Now, so this second part, he talks about the fruit of the repentance. And he mentions here that Lent is time to hear the word of God, to listen, to have a quieter atmosphere in order to be more profoundly disposed, consciously, to hear the word of God, both in our prayers, in the scripture readings, and that. And then he quotes from Psalm 119 on page 7, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. That psalm is recited every single day in the office. It's just simply one of the standard prayers, one of the standard psalms that we use every single day. And the reason for it he gives is because the word of God nourishes our minds and hearts, and the light of revealed truth, it awakens consciences. So there are three things to note there. There is a nourishment, there is a spiritual maturing that takes place, nourishing the mind and the heart, by this light of revealed truth, and awakening then the consciences, which is that cum scientia we mentioned in the pulpit a few weeks ago, this notion of this further consciousness of what the awareness. Because conscience, oftentimes when we think about it, just means moral telling you what to do and not do within you. And that is true. But it is also, why is it doing that? Because it is also very much linked to consciousness, a self-awareness of what is going on. And so when we are catechized properly and we understand our faith, we not only, in a sense, know the rules, we also have a consciousness about these directives which help us make that progress deeper, not only just simply in following the rules, but in actually following the gospel. That's why in these last weeks I've been talking about the individualism in the bulletin and talking about the fact that to understand what the freedom of the children of God is, and last Sunday I used that example of the athleticism, that when you watch the Olympics, you watch them because it's beautiful. You know, this person who goes shooting down, you know, what is it, double black stars or whatever, you know, down the, doing their skiing and all that. It's like, you know, I couldn't walk down it, let alone shoot down the thing at how many miles per hour. But we also know behind that there's been a whole training. But the important aspect is in watching them is that we see it as being their second nature. You know, when I was studying in Switzerland, I used to make jokes, you know, the Swiss are born with skis on, you know, they just, you know, the Canadians are born with skates on their feet, and the Swiss are just born with skis, you know, they're poor mothers. And so, but, it's just because, you know, you see these little kids kind of like shooting down, because that's what they've been doing. So it's just second nature, though. They can't imagine a winter in which you're not skiing. It just doesn't make any sense. And so, but that is the way the gospel is meant to be assimilated and brought into us consciously, conscience and consciously, that it becomes second nature to us. We were joking the other day with someone, because we said, look, I mean, what do we have reduced for fasting now? I mean, the patriarch gives more, and he reminds us of our tradition, we're going to get to that. But in the Latin tradition, we have Good Friday and Ash Wednesday. Well, let's face it quite honestly. How many people even fast on those 2 days? They don't even think about it. Even if you remind them on Sunday, Wednesday's a long ways from Sunday for most people. And so Wednesday comes and goes, or Friday comes and I'm busy and I totally forget about it. Because, let's face it, if you don't do anything for 360, if you go through 363 days of the year and never ever think any ascetical thoughts or practices in your head, and then boom, you have two that you're supposed to only have a meal in. Psychologically, does it really follow? Who knows? But you can't expect people really to do that psychologically when you've cut away everything and you keep the bare minimum. And the reason why the bare minimum is even there, because by the divine law, we must also fast. Our Lord says, unless you fast and do penance, unless you do penance, you shall also perish. You have to do penance. It's part of what God requires of us to do. Okay? Whew. Not brimstone. It's the beauty of athleticism, of a second nature that is assimilated into my life, and that harmonious union between the light of the gospel and my personal human life is a beautiful thing to see. It is not a clash. It is not a confrontation. And there is no friction ultimately. The friction is there is because I'm still stomping my feet as a 2-year-old saying, I don't want to, I don't feel like it. And it's that friction. The rules of the parents on that afternoon when the 2-year-old is throwing a tantrum in the kitchen, there's nothing wrong with those rules. The moment taking place of this drama in the kitchen is horrific. But it's not because there's something wrong with the directives that the parents are trying to give in this household. It's because of this immature child who squealed. And so back to your point, the idea was 50 years ago, if we just started talking about only the nice things, so the act of contrition said, instead of I dread the loss of heaven and the pains of hell, we just said, I'm worried about your just judgments or your just punishments, because we don't want to say the word hell or damnation. So we thought that when that would be given, everyone would be like, oh, that's what I was waiting for. That's why I don't go to Mass. And in fact, not only did they not drive the doors down and come back home, more of them just wandered away.
You also, the first Lent I ever met you, we were talking about fasting. And around here, like Shaw's and Hannaford and stuff, on Friday they got scallops for sale, they got salmon for sale, they got shrimp. So what?
Because there's enough Catholics in the area.
You asked me about fasting, and I said, not a problem. I got scallops, and you have shrimp.
And then you'd have a patriarch's letter.
And you said, wait a second, that's not fasting. You're eating high off the hog. And we weren't.
Well, according to the Latin laws, that's fine, because you just give up red meat.
Yeah, but giving it up to have scallops and shrimp is not exactly
We used to make jokes. Because you go out and eat sushi, and it's like, oh, well, this is really penance, right? What it means is we're not going to have any sake, but you know, come on. But then you get the patriarch's letter, because you're reminding us really what the glory of the East has been, and it's like, boom.
Well, you set me straight.
Yeah. Okay, well, here we go. So there's a lot of this second nature, this, remember, and again, the term fast in the Saxon word means strengthen, okay? And the discipline means the path of learning, dishere, to learn, all right? And to be nourished by this revealed truth. We're talking about the mind and the heart and the conscience and everything. So that's why in paragraph 11, he says, when we know God revealed to us through Jesus Christ, the incarnate God, we know, and this is the thing to know, that the mystery of man who does not exist except in the mystery of the incarnation. Remember, in the Syriac tradition, Adam is made in the image of Christ. Not just a generic philosophical image of infinite intelligence, but of the coming Word of God incarnate. That is what Adam is created in. And so therefore, the mystery of man, what is it to be human? Even just on the natural level, to be human does not exist except in the mystery of the incarnation. That is a universalist vision that even your Buddhist friends, ultimately to be fully human, need to find Christ. That is such a non-modern, postmodern idea in the Western world. But the patriarch is recalling to us, and what is he, so that except in the mystery of the incarnation, when God revealed himself to man in his fullness. And that is actually a phrase from Vatican II. That Christ's entrance into the world is not only to reveal God, everyone agrees on that, but he is also revealing what man is supposed to be in himself. So the patriarch is just calling back to the idea that even on the natural level, human society, human family, human individuals, they will never find their fulfillment until they have the light of Christ to see that fullness. It's not religious imperialism, it's just simply, if you believe the gospel, this is what it means. So it's not a hard truth. It means that you have been given the ability to receive this therapeutic, this healing grace, and in doing so, you have a treasure to be able to give to others. That's the vision of the church, and that's certainly the vision of the East. But it's not the vision of the postmodern world where everybody is kind of just free to pick whatever you want. And of course, now since we're more educated and erudite, we just pick pieces of things that we want so that it becomes this kind of idiosyncratic, you know, mishmash of religiosity, which ultimately doesn't mean anything. It just means it titillates my curiosity. Okay? So, so what all we note then in this paragraph is that man and the human condition can be known correctly and fully only in the light of the incarnation. That means human society, that means human economics, that means the human family, that means the human individual. All of everything is subsumed. This is what the doctrine of Christ the King means. I mean, now again, in the last 50 years, Christ the King put on the left, now we haven't done it, stars are still at the end of October. But in the Latin calendar, they put it at the end of the year, and now it's only an eschatological event that Christ is going to be king at the end of time. Well, that's not the doctrine. Sorry. The doctrine, if you read Quas Primas of Pius XI in 1925, instituting the feast, the doctrine of Christ the King is this, that the whole human reality, family, individual, economics, social, communal, what we call political these days, everything only finds its fulfillment in Christ. And therefore the direction, kingship, the direction, malakot, the direction of the gospel is what gives that fullness to everything. That's why we call Christ King, not just because he's coming to judge the end of the world. And that's what we mentioned to you, historically what was done then in the 60s, when they moved the feast of Christ the King to the end, to make it an eschatological event, they removed the two verses from the hymn. One of the verses say, may the gospel shine its lights upon our arts and our laws. It's probably going to be in your book there. Does it refer to the things? Because remember, lex orandi, lex credendi. So all of a sudden you've changed the lex credendi, so you have to change the lex orandi. Because if Jesus is only king at the eschatological reality at the end of the world, why are you asking in this hymn at Vespers that the light of the gospel infuse all of our laws and all of our arts? Oh, you can't say that because there is a separation of
church and state.
Yeah, which is not a Catholic doctrine at all, but that's a whole other catechism series. So right now, our beloved subdeacon is wrestling with this now. You think you had it bad with the Lenten question? This poor man gets it week after week, and boom, boom, all these landmines keep going off a lot. What had been a very contented and happy ecclesiastical career. And now it's just like, boom, explosion, explosion. And it's admirable and beautiful to watch.
Thank you, Steve.
Mind-bending at times. All right, so when we finish in this paragraph 12, he says that the great Lent that is a time to listen to the voice of God. In the middle of this paragraph to note, the word of God emanates from within his heart, seeking to reach out to reach the heart of man. So you have in the Psalms, cor ad cor loquitur. Cardinal Newman took this as his motto on his coat of arms when he was named cardinal. Heart to heart speaks. Right? Cor ad cor loquitur. And here the patriarch is pointing out it is from the fullness of the sacred heart, that reality, the sacred heart, from his heart seeking to reach the heart of man. So it's just a very beautiful imagery which is given. Okay? So, any questions? No? All right. Well, then just touch on this other page and then we'll finish and we'll take the break. Paragraph 13, the word of God is like rain and snow, for they do not return void to heaven. This is a very fascinating aspect of the creative word. God says, let there be light. There is an aspect of the word. And the word portrayed in the prophets is that it goes out and it creates and it returns to God with life. And so the patriarch is referring to this imagery of the prophet Isaiah. You have Isaiah chapter 55 here in this paragraph. And he says that my word, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but shall do what pleases me, achieving the end for which I sent it. That the word of God in itself is creative and fruitful. It's a very beautiful image that the patriarch is referring us to in this, the prophet Isaiah. All right? And now, this gives you a better understanding why our Lord says to the disciples, when you go out and you go to a home, and when you enter this home, you say, peace be to this house. Pax huic domi in Latin. Shalom beit hono. Right? Peace be to this house. And if there is Baal Shlomo, a man of peace in this house, your peace will remain. And if not, it will return to you. At first, it's a very mysterious thing, but our Lord is making a reference to this creative aspect. You bring Shlomo. You bring peace to this domestic residence, to this house. And if they are disposed, they are Bar Shlomo, they're son of peace, then your peace will reside here. Otherwise, it returns to you, to be given to another. So there is an aspect of reception that has to be there. If the ground is frozen in Nebraska and the waters come, you just get flood and destruction because it can't receive it. It's not receiving it. It's a perfect image. Right? That water will eventually bring life somewhere, but not to that farm in Nebraska because it was unreceptive. And so your peace will return to you. And so it's quite lovely here. And he mentions here also reference to when our Lord appears, he has a two-edged sword. He's portrayed as coming out of his mouth in the book of Revelation, the very beginning. And then he also mentions the reference to the Ephesians, the sword of the Spirit. It cuts off what is erring. It has the ability to separate between spirit and soul, the Word of God. Okay? And so I'll leave you with this Canticle of Canticles, the Song of Songs, chapter 2. I've told you about the one woman who died at 37 of cancers, left behind the 8 children, lost the child, so the miscarriage and everything that weekend. When I returned from Alaska after she died that week, so I anointed her on Friday night. I anointed her on Wednesday, saw her in intensive care on Friday, and I had to go to the mission, so I was in Alaska. She died on that Sunday. When I returned on Tuesday, because the funeral was going to be on Wednesday, when I returned, the men of the parish had made the coffin, this beautiful wooden finished coffin, and then our first grade teacher had, she had decorated, she painted on the outside, because she's a beautiful calligraphist. And so she painted on the outside, and when I came in, I just happened to arrive at the same time when the wake was finishing, and hundreds of people were pouring out of this place. And we had had the wake at the church, because we had too many people, because she was only 37. And when I went in, the funeral home was taking the coffin, because you couldn't leave them in the church. So the funeral was taking them back that night. But before it left, I was able to see what our first grade teacher had painted. And she painted around the edge of it. Of course, the men had carved at the foot of the coffin the initials of the mother. And they had carved the initials of the baby that was miscarried that weekend at the head. And then the coffin was open when I first came. And what they had done is they had taken the baby's remains during this miscarriage, and they placed them, the women lined, so the men made the coffin, and the women lined the whole coffin with satin and made the pillows and everything. And they also made the sachet for the body of the baby, which was pinned next to the mother's head in this coffin. It was all quite, I mean, very, very moving. This had a profound impact upon the parish, obviously. And it was absolutely extraordinary to see. But as they were closing the coffin to take the body away and all that, we had the painting around it. And it was, "Arise, my beloved, my lovely one, and come," from the canticle, from the Song of Songs. But as soon as I saw it, I knew the rest of the verse, and that was the sermon. So what I want to give you a reference here in this kind of creation and this fruitfulness is that in the Canticle of Canticles, chapter 2, in the ancient translation, so out of the Vulgate, verse 12 of the second chapter says, "The flowers have appeared in our land, right? And the time of pruning has come." That's the classical text. Now, probably if you look in the translation you have in your home, it'll say the time of singing has come. But the Vulgate has, this is the time, which of course springtime is. Things start to blossom, you prune things back. Now is the time when the flowers are beginning to appear in the land. The time of pruning has come. The voice of the dove is heard in our land. And in verse 13, what was the continuance of what was painted around the edge in this beautiful gold calligraphy was, "Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come." That is an extraordinarily beautiful, of course, the fathers of the church continually make reference, both Israel and God in the Old Testament, the church and Christ, and the individual soul being called. So the flowers have appeared, fruitfulness has appeared, and the time of pruning has appeared. So arise and come, my beautiful one. So it's a very lovely vision, and I wanted to link it with what the patriarch's talking about, this fruitfulness of the word. We have to stop being afraid. Christians are some of the most timid and backward people that I come across. They have somehow a fear of talking about Christianity. Because now if you talk about Christianity, of course, you're automatically labeled as a bigot by the public media. But the way it needs to be done is not to pound someone down, but to give the imagery of the beauty of this. You don't say to them, "Well, you know, you're never going to be fully human until you're Christian." That doesn't make any sense to anyone. But you have to have the understanding that human life only flourishes in its fullness. And if I don't have the conviction, I'll never be able to convince somebody of it. But when I have that conviction, yes, you can't say that to them. That'd be a case of throwing pearls before swine. Hey, you know, get it together. Because you won't be a fully human person until you're Christian. They're not going to understand that. But that is a beautiful doctrine. That is pearls. But you can't, and our Lord says, don't throw your pearls to swine because they'll turn on you and tear you. And so just to give them that doctrine, they wouldn't understand and it would just cause greater confusion. That's an example of that gospel. Okay? All right. So now we'll take a brief break and grab our coffee. Here we go.
I'm just learning myself.
The second section on prayer. The second section on prayer, because I want to deal with the psychological aspects of the discipline of fasting and penance. And I want to clarify the questions on the excommunications of becoming a mason that we talked about last week.
Yeah.
And then, which I can show you already now, is finally, we have finished the reprinting of Core Bishop Eads and Archbishop Zayek's book.
All right.
Thank you. And it is gorgeously published with a dust cover, black binding, beautiful gold hardcover. And so I did not bring the whole box over because I knew even when we had catechism books, it's like, oh, I don't have any money now. So since everyone seems to only carry $3 in their pocket, next week it will come. But if you want to, these books will be $24 because they're hardcovered and they're very beautiful. In fact, the pictures that they cleaned up with the computer digitalization, the black and white photos in this book are better than the original. When I saw them, it was quite stunning what you could do with the computer. And this has also the pamphlets on what is the ascetic life and what does it mean to the Maronite tradition by Archbishop Zayek. So I put that in the beginning because otherwise the book on St. Charbel, it's clear that when Father Ead, when Core Bishop Ead is writing it in 1955 and 1965 in his edition, he's presuming that the people reading this book have a knowledge of what the ascetic and hermetic life is. Which was clear that when I was reading, I thought it was quite beautiful, but then as I started thinking about it, not even the average Maronite probably really. And so I came across Archbishop Zayek's book on the call of the desert, a pamphlet on the ascetic life, and he even gives you a calendar of all the saints month by month of all of our hermits and hermitesses who were on our calendar to remind us of the great importance. So I put that in the first part of the book. So it's not just simply a reprinting of Core Bishop Ead's book introducing Saint Charbel. It is also kind of amplifying and understanding. And then it's been edited also to include the canonization of the Ed. Okay?
Can you pass that on so
we
can see it?
Sure, if you want. No, then you don't pay attention to the class. That's terrible. That's like serving cupcakes and trying to have class. You can look at it after. All right, here we go. Oh, see how long I've been out of a class? I almost fell right into that one. Now we're coming back. No, I just want to show you that book. No. So we come back to prayer, this section in the middle. So he talks about penance first, and then this section on the prayer in the middle here. We actually laugh because we're thinking, okay, we announced this letter was at the doors, and there are about 25 or 30 of them went out. And then you're wondering, okay, so it's up to this little band of people to have to communicate to all your cousins what the patriarch is actually writing in there. That we're actually spending weeks here on, you know, talking about it, pulling it apart.
Although it's not fair for me because the only Maronites I know are here.
Which is great. Well, you have a very fine choice and taste then. So, prayer in the second section, paragraph 14. Remember what is dealt here is that when we talk about prayer, in its simplest definition means the elevation and the mind and the heart to God. And the patriarch mentions this here, right? It is linking then the prayer, this elevation of the spirit towards the hidden one, and our contemplation, and of course, we're talking about the hearing of the word of God, the lectio divina. And so what the prayer is doing, is meant to be doing, is the changing of our life. We're entering deeper into this light of perception, judgment, action. And so prayer is the initial part of this perception of how we see the world. And so it's a change of life, our conversion, penance in the first section we refer to as being. It's also meant to do, as a second point, to attain then to a deeper understanding, right, of meaning, and we've seen earlier just not only meaning of our faith, but also meaning of human life, what it is supposed to be. Does human life have a value? Does it have any intrinsic value? I mean, I find this absolutely absurd that, you know, for all of these decades now, we've been teaching all of our children that you're nothing more than a monkey, and then we get upset when they act like chimpanzees. That you have to be nice to each other. It's like, well, if there's any place where you're not going to find niceness, it's in the animal kingdom. So if you're just telling everyone they're an animal, you should not be surprised if you finish with just animal behavior. Okay? So the meaning of both human life, the meaning of the gospel. And of course, these two things will lead to the third point, that what prayer and this contemplation is doing is it helps us attain to a more perfect healing and integration, the healing of the wounds. And then as a fourth point, it also deepens the foundation of peace and contentedness, happiness in the true sense, the contentedness, right? Which is not jubilation and dancing on tables. Happiness is the contented presence of a state of existence or condition. And then lastly, within the prayer life is also to obtain a more perfect liberty of the spirit. And when you're free, God will give you the things that you have to say. And you may be able in a conversation in the local diner to talk about the fullness of human life, which is only known within the revelation of the incarnation. And God will give you a way to say to this specific person. And even if they turn around and spit in your face and it doesn't work, your peace is never shaken. Because your concern is, again, is to communicate something which is profoundly beautiful and lightsome. It gives life, illumination to understanding. It's, I say, as we lose more and more religion, philosophy, even a sense of nature in the Western world, it is not a surprise that we have people dropping like flies by suicide and through addictions. It's just not a surprise. And until we resolve the causes, you're, no matter how many millions of dollars you want to pour into whatever it is, oxycodone or whatever these different remedies are, that will not resolve anything. So, the prayer life is the way that we assimilate this material into our lives. Right? And that's why we used to talk about morning prayers, night prayers, Latin tradition, the Angelus, saying the Angelus morning and at noon and at night, stopping for 3 minutes to commemorate the incarnation. These are small practices, but they go a long way to deepen our sense of the presence. Right? And quite honestly, this practice of prayer is spoken of from the very beginning of the church, in the Didache, in your first, second century documents of the Syriac Jewish Christianity. It talks about prayer morning, noon, and night. So Christianity is clearly from the beginning not only an ascetic movement, but it is also a system of prayer. A system of prayer for everyone, not just the priests, the nuns, and the monks. Right? For everyone. Okay? All right. So, that's what's in this whole section on hearing the word of God. And that's why he says in the second line of paragraph 14, he who does not hear the word of God does not know how to pray. I mean, actually, you come across that quite often. Now, people will just say, well, what does it mean to pray? What do you do? Prayer for a lot of people means you go to a building. Right? They don't understand what it means personally to pray. And so prayer, because they didn't know that, that's why so many of them just go off to yoga and meditation and become basically Buddhist, because all of a sudden you've taught me something, and I never had any idea what prayer was, going to church on Sunday and listening to a preacher drilling on for 2 hours. Okay. Doesn't affect me at all, I don't care. So what's prayer? What is prayer? What is prayer? This is the emptiness, and someone comes along and says, look, I give you a system, this is how you do it. Cross your legs this way, sit this way, pay attention to your breathing, and you do all this stuff. Because there was nothing there. Remember the image within the gospel. The devil is cast out, then his place is sweet and slept, and then the devil comes back with seven others, and you're worse off than you were before. There's nothing evil in the place, it's just you didn't replace it with the Spirit of God. All right. So, and that's when he mentions in the next line, the elevation of the mind, the heart, and thoughts to God. Okay? Is that not what we do when we address a prominent figure? How many people, even when they try to pray, do this in a distracted manner? Right. And so he just uses the image, you know, do you actually sit using your phone if you were talking to the governor? Would you expect him just simply to wait while you, oh, it'll be quick, just 2 seconds and I'll finish this email, oh, this text. That's insulting. And yet, our lives are lived this way, of this kind of frantic cacophony, just of noise. So how do we ever expect to direct God until we can find this quieting to to be able to address him without the figurative cell phone in our hands, yes.
If we could get more people in the parish to take home the icon, because I know you take it home, I know I do.
I know, but we just had one team jump ship, so now you're down to 4 weeks.
When I have that on my kitchen table every morning, like I know Paula has, Mary has hers on her living room table, that's contemplative. I take it out, read it, it's quiet.
In the Eastern tradition, we have an icon corner. You have in the corner of your main room of your where you pray, you have your icons. You have the patron saints of your children. You have the patron saint for your family. You have Our Lord, Mother of God. You always have a lamp burning.
But we could get more people to be contemplative, like you're saying. We just need to get them on board.
Well,
with that.
Unfortunately, too, at this point, we have to train now for this because it's not something that we learn from our parents. Normally, at this point. Normally, when you had an icon corner, your parents were teaching you from the time you were still, using your diapers, in front of these things. It's just something that you grew up with so that prayer became a second nature to us. But that, all of those traditions are broken. Yes, but it's perfectly true. The icons are a tremendous way to move towards this contemplation and a life of prayer. All right. So that's why the patriarch just points out here the needs for some type of seclusion. Removed from sounds of his surroundings, his worries, concerns, in order to facilitate his prayers. And then at the bottom of this paragraph, he gives a quotation from Blessed Abuna Yakuba. He's a Capuchin monk. Does not the lamp shine in solitude and is extinguished by the wind? So if the lamp is in the room, its flame is steady. You stick it out on the front porch, it'll flicker and maybe be blown out. That's why we shouldn't be under any illusion that we can just pray anywhere at any time in any manner. It's not true. We live under an illusion that way. Okay, so the next page on page 9. So, nor must they emanate from boredom. Right? For the Lord commands, watch and pray that you may not undergo the tests. That is related to Acadia, one of the seven capital sins. It's often translated as sloth, but sloth too often for us means like laziness. But Acadia means listlessness, actually. You just be sapped of any energy to do something. I can't pray. I can't do these things. Acadia, the fathers of the desert refer to it as being the noonday devil from Psalm 90. Because it'll strike you in the middle of your actually moving along spiritual life. Because eventually you're like, why am I doing all of this? And a lot of people have wandered away from their religion and the church because of Acadia. They've gotten to the point of saying, I've done this for 15 years, that's enough. I've done this for 40 years, that's enough. I don't need to do this anymore. And then they wander away and the devil wins. Because that's not the fulfillment of grace bringing us into the kingdom of light. And I've lost all the other moments of time, which are moments of grace bringing us into the fullness of the kingdom. Which is why our Lord says, he who perseveres to the end shall be saved. If you actually read the whole gospel, there's a lot of sobering things in it. We like the little holy card versions of just a single line popped out. But that's why the patriarch's reminding us that we have to be vigilant. Our Lord is always saying, watch, be awake. Watch and pray that you may not undergo temptation, undergo the test. All right. At the end of paragraph 16, finishing up this section, he mentions the parable of the publican and the sinner within the temple. And how the publican stands afar off, and all he keeps saying is, "Oh God, be merciful to me, a sinner." That's a prayer in itself. That's the Jesus prayer. Jesus, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And you just say a gazillion of them every day, and it becomes, if you haven't read it, I highly recommend you to read The Way of the Pilgrim. It's a Russian Orthodox classic. It is beautiful. You don't need yoga or Buddhism to teach you anything. Just read The Way of the Pilgrim. And so he mentions that at the top, and then he mentions St. Louis, St. Louis. king of France. He was criticized for devoting long times to prayer. This was also said of Franco, if you want to know the truth. They're going to rip his body up in the Valle de los Caídos now. But Franco was known that whenever any monumental decision for the state had to be taken, he would always make sure that he spent a minimum of 2 hours in prayer before making the decision.
So he was a Christian?
Oh, no.
Frank, I didn't know that. Huh.
That's shocking to me. Maybe he was just this cruel dictator.
No, he was a slightly liberal Catholic, but he was definitely Catholic. Oh, no, definitely Catholic.
Huh.
Well, because he's not Jose Antonio de Primo de Rivera. He's not. That's an integral Catholic vision. Franco was a nationalist who, because of that, was also profoundly Catholic. Jose Antonio de Primo de Rivera was a Catholic, and because of that profoundly, he was also patriotic. So there's a little shift in between the two of them. So his body is he's buried by the main altar in the Valle de los Caídos. Jose Antonio is on one side, Franco's on the other side. But the reason for I give is because Franco, before any major state decision, would spend 2 hours in prayer. And once he came out of that and made a decision, nothing and no one would change his opinion after the 2 hours that he would spend in the prayer. And so I give it because here you have St. Louis. I'm not saying Franco was a saint. I'm just saying is that there's a different Catholic way as a vision, as a politician and a leader, to govern a country. And here is the funny one, because it says that St. Louis had people criticize him because he spent too much time in prayer. He's at Mass every day. He would serve Mass. He'd go out to see the lepers. And so they said he was wasting too much time, devoting a long time to prayer and thus neglecting the affairs of the kingdom. And the saint replied, "If my prayer time had been dedicated to hunting and entertainment," normal kingly things, right? "As some people of the court do, then no one would have criticized me. If I went off and spent the entire day hunting, no one would have thought about it. I spent 2 hours praying and doing spiritual reading, like, oh, you're just wasting time." And that's very encouraging, because it tells you that that attitude that we recognize very much in the modern world has always been around. Fortunately, we don't have people of the caliber of St. Louis around, so we're a little bit cut short here. Now, that's the section on prayer. Pretty straightforward. It's very much linked to what we were doing on the question of penance. Now, I have 4 points here that I wanted to do before the question of the fasting, because it lays out, just purely on a psychological level, the ichidoyuto. Remember ichidoyo? We talked about the singularity of vision in the Syriac tradition. Ichidoyo. Ichidoyo, ichidoyuto. So the singleness of vision. Because that's very much linked to the ascetic. Of all the Christian traditions, it's the Jewish Christianity in those first generations that are the most ascetic. I mean, some of them do degenerate off into heretical movements, but it's very much the vision of the ichidoyuto. Let me do the clarification of the Masonic first. And then that way when we go on, but Paul, we only get 2 of the 4 points done, but anyway. So what I wanted, when we mentioned this, because it looked like it was a bit of a shock last week about the question of excommunications of masonry. Now, right at the very beginning, we talked about, up until 1983, masonry was always listed as being, if you joined the Masons, it would be an excommunication from the church. Period, and it was listed explicitly. What happened is in 1983, because there's always been jostling around in the offices of the Vatican, somebody decided in the redaction of this code to drop the name of masonry. So the immediate question becomes then, does that no longer mean to be a mason? Right? And of course, the code is promulgated, and now you have this doubt. Now, there shouldn't be a doubt, because one of the principles of canon law is that the principle is that you have continuity interpretation. Benedict XVI gave it the fantastic name of the hermeneutics of continuity. But that's always been a principle of law. If you have a new law that appears, and there is an aspect which is not clear in itself, you will always refer back to the subject matter of the previous legislation to clarify that doubt. which means immediately looking back, that canon is still there, and that canon refers to Masonry explicitly. So that's why in 1983, the same, basically the same year that the code comes out, Rome says, yes, Masonry is part of this still. Okay? So what was decided by the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, right? Cardinal Ratzinger, in 1983, what they clarified and said, they actually don't answer the excommunication question directly, which is also typical of the modern bureaucracy. But what they say is that to join Masonry would be a mortal sin, and one would not be allowed to receive the sacraments in that mortal sin. And so that was the clarification immediately after the name. So they didn't talk about the excommunication, but they said this is incompatible with Catholicism. It's incompatible with Christianity, therefore it would be gravely sinful, it would be a mortal sin, and therefore it would bar the individual from receiving the sacraments until such time as they remove their membership. And that's why the specific quotation in that judgment was, the Church's negative judgment in regard to the Masonic Association remains unchanged. End of quote. That's 1983. Okay? Now in 1985, the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops they made a statement then 2 years after that, following on this decision of the Vatican of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, the American bishops then said in 1985 that it is impossible to belong to the Catholic Church and to the Freemasons at the same time. So they essentially reiterate the previous decision, if you want, from the Vatican. That's 1985. Now what is also interesting here is that in 1996, I don't know if you remember back in the, you had Bishop Bruskovitz in Lincoln, Nebraska, and this man was always whacking the hornet's nest. Okay? But he never really followed up, he made these declarations, but he never really followed up with an integrated action within Lincoln. So it always kind of like fell on its face in practice. Though he made the right noises, and so he was being heralded as this great conservative. And again, the terms liberal and conservative in Catholicism don't really mean anything. There is a doctrine. Whether you believe it or not just makes you a heretic or a believing Catholic. It doesn't make you just kind of a liberal Catholic. There's not, those choices don't exist in Catholicism. We're not Anglicans. We don't have a high, middle, and low church, okay? And so the American bishops repeat that. Now Bishop Bruskovitz, what he did in 1996 is he made an explicit legislation within his diocese was joining the Masonic sect was a 1 month interdict, which meant during that month, you weren't excommunicated, so you were still on the fringes of the church's membership, but you could not receive the sacraments, and if you died during that month, as an example, you would not receive a Christian burial because you're under interdict. And interdict means the sacraments cannot be done. I mean, in the Middle Ages, you'd have entire kingdoms put under interdict, and that just meant the priests were now all basically on strike or something. You know, the Pope just said, that's it, no more ceremonies. And the only ones who would receive ceremonies then would be the dying. And that would be it. But otherwise, the sacramental system just stopped. Okay. So, that's an interdict. And why we say a 1 month interdict? Because within those 4 weeks, if you do not withdraw your membership, Bishop Bruskowitz gave as the canon, if you do not withdraw your membership during that month, after that month, it will become an excommunication. Okay? Now, there were appeals made against this from the diocese to the Vatican, the Roman Supreme Court, the Rota. And the decisions of Bruskovitz in 1996, those judgments and that law were all upheld by the Vatican in 2006. They were completely fine to make those interdict and then declaration of excommunication. So that's 2006, and then to bring it up more closer to date, in 2013, there was a Catholic priest in France, in Megeve, France, who joined the Masonic order.
Why?
Fraternity. Why does anyone join the Masons? Right? So he joined for social and political and business connections, I suppose. But in any case, in 2013, after joining the Masons, he was stripped of all functions at the request of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. So he basically stripped of his priesthood. Not of his priesthood as such, but all functioning. He had no functions. It's a bit like when you had the Sandinistas, was it the Sandinistas, Nicaragua? You had the one priest who was a minister. When John Paul II came there, he rebuked it publicly and told him, you cannot be a minister within the state and a priest at the same time. And the priest decided, okay, fine, and he apostatized from his priesthood and continued in political position.
Was he the one that also came up with that,
I don't know if it's the same one or not.
Liberation theology.
So that's a whole other thing yourself in there. All right, so there's your clarification. So I don't think it's, no, it wasn't the same, okay. Same man. All right, so that's your clarification. So when did, when was this partnership done up? What year do you know?
Bob Wilson just mentioned it to Larry down here for Coffee and Muffins about a few weeks ago. And he said there are Masons in the Augusta Gardner area who are Catholics. And I knew nothing about this. And Bob said they're going to be excommunicated.
Yes.
So I asked.
They're excommunicated. And even if they're not excommunicated, strictly speaking, they're all living in a state of public sin. And therefore should be refused the sacraments.
Why didn't they just join Rotary or
Columbus? This is exactly why the Knights of Columbus was established in the 1800s, in order to give the Catholic men a fraternity plus insurance and support, mutual support, because the attraction was always to go to the Masons for this fraternal political business association. Okay? Yes?
But in their defense, how many times I have in the last 30 or 40 years have Catholics been
catechized?
Catechized or re-educated concerning Freemasonry.
Exactly. That takes you back. That takes you back to the prophecy of Ezekiel. I make you a watchman, and if they die in their sins, their blood is on you. That's why we mentioned Saint John Chrysostom says the majority of priests go to hell. Father of the Church, doctor. And he's not saying because they're all evil. He says because they do not understand the power that they carry. And they do not live according to it. Okay? Oh, it's such a happy classes we're having here. All right, let me give you at least the first point. Because when we come back next week, we're going to talk about these details, which you can easily read. But there's a little bit of commentary on them, and then we should finish up next week. Now, just purely on, I want to leave you to think about for this next week, purely on the psychological level of asceticism. You know, from the 70s onwards, from the late 60s onwards, the explosions of 68, okay, you know, all the movements, the protests in 64, 65, everybody's still in shirts and jackets and ties, and you know, there's still something hanging on, at least externally, right? But by the time you reach it, it all starts breaking. It starts breaking because not everybody wearing those ties is actually ordered within themselves, okay? And so once they go, okay, we pull it off, the next thing you know, we're on tie-dye, okay? Now, we brought this up. You know, I told you something. You know, in the 1950s, there were 100,000 adults converting to Catholicism every year. So what happened? You had a lot of Protestant theologians in the 1950s who were wetting their pants because they thought, this is it. America's going to become a Catholic nation. Then you elected a Catholic president in 1960. And then somehow, within the period of 12 years, it all went like a house of cards. And you go, well, so what was going on here? Well, that becomes the question of those hundreds of thousands of people, how were they catechized? And how deeply would they come from? And this is why now, anyone who comes to me, and I've been doing this for years, any adult who comes to me, I tell them at least a year, and a minimum of 1 hour per week. And now it's becoming hour and a half, 2 hours a week, and we go now closer to 2 years. So we're getting back to where we used to be evangelizing the pagan missions is what they are. And so, you know, in Africa with the white fathers in the end of the 19th century, they had a minimum of a 3-year catechumenate. And then after they did 3 years of catechumenate, before they were actually baptized, they would have to sign, because most of them were illiterate, they have to at least put their mark on, understanding at this moment before your baptism that if persecutions break out, you have to choose fidelity and death if that's the proposition rather than renouncing your faith. So not only did they get 3 hours or 3 years of catechesis, they also had to say, I clearly understand this is the sovereign reality of my life. Okay, now we baptize you. But that practice gave you the Ugandan martyrs, St. Charles Lwanga and the other 20-some, 30-some young men who died in a very modern situation. Very modern situation. You had these boys, these 15 and 16-year-olds, pounding on the doors of the priest, please baptize us now because we want to die for Christ. Because they don't, because I've only, you've only catechized me for a year and a half now. And you watch the grace of the faith, even before their baptism, taking hold of them. And so the priest started baptizing these young men as they were being arrested. And within months, they were all martyred. Torn apart by dogs, burned alive, drowned, decapitated, all kinds of ways. But that practice gave you the, which to this day in Uganda and in Eastern Africa are national holidays. Everything's closed on June 2nd. And people from all the neighboring countries come to Kampala for this huge celebration of St. Charles Lwanga and the martyr, Ugandan martyrs. It's glorious, absolutely glorious. So, this notion, the reason why I bring that up is because the ascetic notion that there is an effort required to anything serious has evaporated among Catholics. Just evaporated. And so the problem is what we used to know up until fairly recently. When we came, I mean, this is totally external, but it reflects something going on within the person. When we came to the divine presence, we prepared ourselves in a way of coming through Eucharistic fast, which used to be from midnight, no food, not even water until you went to communion, from midnight. And we also presented ourselves physically in our Sunday best. We may have been dirt poor, and we had only one set of clothes for church, but it came out on that Sunday. Now, part of it was also the presentation, but part of it also alleviated people in their poverty. You, one day a week, you could look above just simply being living in a slum, being poor. And so you had a clothing that was directed to the presentation before the altar. Is it a big detail? No. But what we have learned, though, is that you keep cutting away details, and in the end, you have nothing left. As they say, the devil is indeed. The details are what surround us, not because they're the importance, but because psychologically, they both express what is interior, and they support what is interior. You can't tell me that if you show up to Mass all the time, wearing flip-flops and a bathing suit, that you're not going to start thinking less of the altar. If you're dressed the way you do for your back porch, psychologically you cannot help but see the altar as being your back porch. Yes?
Do you think that many of the churches today look like someone's back porch? And
well,
that
that's a different question.
Yeah.
I was just going to say.
Well, that's the architectural book that came out like 5 years ago called Ugly as Sin.
That's right.
And it deals with modern architecture.
That's why, like, when some people say, well, the church should sell all the artwork and whatnot, it's like, why would they want to give up their grandparents' sacrifice and investment for something beautiful for their community?
Yes. So, Akin, where we get our word askesis from ultimately, askesis, which means to practice, to train. So askesis is the action of training. So the same way that anything that has importance in our life, we train for. You go to university, you get your certification. For heaven's sakes, you do a decade of training to become a medical doctor. Mm-hmm. You know that things that are of value cost. The kingdom of heaven, the ultimate defined at the fulfillment of human life and salvation in the divine life. Our Lord says, you must change your attitude and do penance, or you shall also likewise perish. Perish likewise, meaning like what? Like the rest of the wounded individuals who do nothing. This is what we've lost. Psychologically, we're not even talking about supernatural faith. You know, people who could never say the rosary will now spend hours doing yoga each week. They couldn't do a 15-minute rosary, but they'll go stretch over some inflated ball someplace and not think anything about it. This is how insane we have arrived at this point, is that we don't have time for a rosary. You don't have 15 minutes, really, out of the entire day. Your entire day is so efficiently used. Do you never surf the web? Do you never do texting? Do you the question is how, and that's why the idea of asceticism is training. What we do, asceticism is training. And that's why we talked about the example of the icon corner, and your little kids just knelt with you, fell on the ground, whined, complained. Junior threw the rosary across the room, and it was just a chaos. But eventually, Junior gets older, and then he starts kneeling with his older brothers and sisters. Well, how many parents have said, oh, we can't do this? You know, the two-year-old flops around, cries and screams, like he does over his meal, like he does going to bed. But you don't allow him to run around like a feral child. I mean, we do now. But you never allow him to run around like a feral child because it's time for bed. You finally insisted they go to bed. The same thing with the prayer life. You know, some of the captives just drop the whole prayer life. It's too much effort. Well, you're training them. You're training them that it doesn't matter. And religion then disappears when I don't have to get in this car because I have a big body now. That's why it's all very logical how these things have happened. So this asceticism, the only one I want to leave you with tonight is this point A. That the roots of asceticism, the root of asceticism is moral formation. Why do we train? Because we're training people to act in a way. Why does the Marine sergeant scream in your face when you're 18-year-old twit? Because he wants you to be a heroic Marine and stand up straight and make your mother proud, right? Because he wants you to act moral. Moral just refers to the way that we act. So the root of asceticism, training, psychologically is for moral formation. And ultimately what it means in the Christian context is the liberation of a human person by concentrating, centralizing all of their inner forces so that they have a command and an autonomy of themselves through this training. Yes?
Just a mention that some people might appreciate the DVD Integrate Silence of the Carthusians.
Oh, yes. The Germans went gaga over that.
It was, I own it, but it's very beautiful. Very beautiful.
It's very funny because those who know the monastic life, you watch this and you're saying, why was Europe like going wild over this? It's just a picture of monks just doing their normal. Because that's how far we've just apostatized. They were so intrigued by this because, but you could never have made that film back in the 50s. No one would have paid to go see that. Certainly not the way it was like in Germany and in Europe. It was absolutely extraordinary. So the same way that, not because it wasn't important, because people already know it, so that it doesn't matter. And on the other hand, something like the Da Vinci Code would never have been made in the 50s because no one would have gone to see it. Because it's so stupid. If you know anything about Christianity, it is dumb from start to finish. And so in the 1950s, your cousin would have gone and said, oh, it's really ridiculous. It isn't even about Christianity. And you wouldn't have seen it. So you have this flip side where all of a sudden, a silent film, basically, you know, about a monastic living. It's like, woo, this is exotic. And then the Da Vinci Code, which is just nuts, everyone's like, oh, this is really interesting. It's only interesting because you have no idea what Christianity actually is. So you know, on this point, just to finish up on this, that the postmodern society loses its memory about the personal and communal ascesis. We used to train, this is a whole reason for public schools, was to train you how to be good little wasps. Okay? That's what you were being trained to do. But there was an understanding, is we are going to make you wasps. Which I told you last week is why all the Catholics freaked out, said you're not going to make my little Italian bambino become a wasp. And so we built an entire parallel universe of education. And it, glorious it was. Glorious it was. And so, in the postmodern society, it has lost its memory. We're just talking about the psychological level now. Because even at the public school level, with multiculturalism and everything, what are we actually trying to accomplish here? The postmodern society has lost its memory, is losing its memory, has lost its memory by severing ethics, moral behavior, from ascetic roots. You know, why did you behave this way or not behave this way? Why are you being trained? Severing ethics from its ascetic roots of training, of the training process. This loss of memory about the personal and the communal development is the reason why everything's fragmenting, just purely on the natural level, right? Besides the question about religion. So therefore, the modern or the Western society finds itself incapable of forming people who live ethically. Because what is the, how are you supposed to behave? No one enunciates what principle. Like I said, the principle that they're actually trained in is you are biologically an animal who descended from monkeys. So the ethical behavior should be hairless monkeys. That's what you are trained to think as. Therefore, your actions are going to flow from that. We've severed the whole ethical origin of the actions. At least when they made the public schools in the 19th century, they knew they wanted to train up a whole new generation of little heretics. We want wasps that behave themselves and say yes ma'am, no ma'am, and who follow the laws and who speak English. Right? They knew what they were doing. I'm not saying that it was great. But the reason why it worked for so long is because they understood you train them for a certain type of behavior. And that's what we're losing in the modern world, which is why the modern society finds itself incapable of forming people who live ethically. Again, not as Catholics, but just simply from some principle of norm. And therefore, it is paralyzed. Society is paralyzed in face of violence, hatred, bigotry, abuse, and all of the other infinite number of phobias, okay? It labels things without resolving the fragmentation because it's not dealing with the principle that is actually behind it, which is leading to some kind of ethical. So this is just purely on the psychological level of what a scheme, a training, actually winds up meaning and what is necessary. The best that we come up with ethically is what? Be nice. That's about as close as we get to a principle. But the word nice itself historically actually means subtle. A nice distinction in English originally meant a subtle distinction. It didn't mean be kind. Be kind is great. If we could get to that point, that would be helpful. So this is just the first point to talk about why ascesis is necessary. You will go to school at 7 o'clock each day. You will get on the bus and you will be in class at 8. And you will stay there till 3:30. And you will do this until you are 16. We required asceticism out of them. They had to do something in training. Okay, that's point one. Any questions? Wonderful. You're brilliant, thank you. Okay, we'll finish up with our prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. O God,
you are before all ages, and exist from age to age.
You are resplendently glorified in unsearchable light. Through your word, you bring forth light and give us each day. A radiant day and source of all light, we glorify you, adore you, and offer you praise night and day. Accept our praise and answer our prayer. Send us your abundant blessings through the mercy of your Messiah. To him, with you and the Holy Spirit, be glory, honor, power, and thanksgiving, now and forever. Amen.
Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
O Mary, conceived without sin,
pray for us who have recourse to you.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Have a good evening. Beautiful
Thank you, Lord.